Thank you for joining. I'm Julie Ann Bittner, and this is Insight with Insiders. One of the many things that I'm extremely passionate about is empowering staffing owners through education, resource, and expertise. It's why I started this podcast series, Insight with Insiders. I wanted to bring industry experts to the table to discuss issues, challenges, and emerging trends in the staffing industry. Today, I've asked Sarah Davis and Chris Leddy with Becker LLC to join me. Both are experienced attorneys. Sarah is an associate with the firm's corporate department and business services group, where she focuses on mergers, acquisitions, and other commercial transactions. Sarah has been involved in the private practice since 2015, specializing in drafting and negotiating of complex financial agreements and transactions. Sarah is also an active member of the staffing group and has presented and provided thought leadership for the various trade associations across the country. Chris is of counsel to the firm and an active member of the staffing group. Chris has experience in drafting, maintaining, and negotiating client, employee, and contract agreements, creating and implementing employee compensation and benefit plans, ensuring compliance with federal and state labor laws and regulations as it pertains to services delivered to all states, and drafting, maintaining, and negotiating legal content in private and public contracts throughout the United States, Canada, and Europe. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Sarah Davis and Chris Leddy with Becker LLC. Welcome, Sarah and Chris.
Thank you.
Thank you, Julie.
Well, this is going to be an exciting topic today. I'm very excited about it because it's something that I have ongoing communication with my clients about, ongoing questions and sometimes debates. So we tackle this, and I'm sure you do as well with your clients, either on a weekly basis or sometimes even daily.
All the time.
Right? And it's that ongoing question, do I classify them as an employee or can I classify this person as an independent contractor? And it's important to know the difference between who is really an employee and who is really an independent contractor when operating a business, because misclassifying somebody is costly to your business. So let's first discuss and get a general overview of the importance of the correct analysis of an employee versus independent contractor.
Perfect. I think that's a great place to start. The analysis is just so important because it touches upon so many things. So depending on whether you're an employee or an independent contractor, it touches on employee benefit rules, wage withholding rules, the application of workers' comp rules, state unemployment liability rules. So it touches on all of this. And generally, if you're not an employee, the company doesn't have to pay or withhold for Social Security or Medicare taxes, pay into workers' compensation fund, pay into unemployment compensation funds, withhold income taxes, pay minimum wage, overtime, provide certain leave benefits. There's so many things that come with this analysis and making sure that the classification is correct. So because of this, and because independent contractor reduces a company's legal and tax obligations, the IRS has become very focused on this. The DOL has become very focused on this. In 2011, they even went so far as the Secretary of Labor reached an agreement with the DOL that they're going to start sharing information. They're going to work together. They're really going to work together to try and tackle this whole misclassification issue because it's such a big issue. There are a lot of state agencies as well that are partnering with the IRS, OSHA, Employment Benefit Security Administrations. All different agency leaders are getting involved in this. So much so, the 2022 budget that came out, the Department of Labor is actually calling for several billions of dollars to go into this boost for protection of workers' classification issues. So it's just so important, especially with this focus now. So you've got to make sure you're classifying these workers correctly, or there's going to be ramifications for sure.
We've definitely heard that there is more of a focus on it. We've seen more of even where they're going in and doing audits, correct? Audits have gone way up, is that? So now that we understand the analysis is why it's so important, The big misunderstanding is how is the test? How do you use that test? And how do you go throughout that? I mean, there is a lot of confusion around the tests. So can you explain that to our listeners? Because that, I mean, even me, I went through it. There's the common law, there's the ABC, then there's some other things. So help us understand that better.
Sure. So every state has different laws, right? Different standards. Some are very similar. Some are diametrically different, right? But they're generally speaking, they're a form of three different tests. You're going to have the IRS test, you're going to have the ABC test, or the DOL's economic realities test. And it really depends on the type of claim that you have, whether it's a wage claim, unemployment claim, workers' compensation claim, and how the state applies the particular test in that situation. All these tests, like I said, are very similar in that they're looking for things like control. Are the services being performed outside the normal activities of the business? And is there an opportunity for profit or loss by this contractor? Right. However, the difference between the ABC test, the IRS test, and economic realities test is that the economic realities test and IRS test, they're factor-based, and they're looked at in the totality of the circumstances. Whereas the ABC test is a three-prong test. Three prongs consist of that the worker is free from control and direction, that the worker performs work outside the normal course of the hire entity's business, and that worker is customarily engaged in an independently established trade, occupation, or business. So once you, if you fail any parts of those tests, if they find that you didn't get that A, B, or C on the ABC test, if you hit all two, if you hit two, but you miss the third one, you automatically fail, right? It's not a factor-based test like the other two tests are. So it becomes a much greater hurdle to get over if you're in an ABC test state.
Mm-hmm.
Also, the burden is put on the employer in those states too, to prove that they are, because they're going into the assumption that this person should be an employee. I mean, that's how the estate will look at it, as they're going to say, no, you proved to me that they should be an independent contractor. So you have that additional burden. Usually when the defendant doesn't have the burden, the plaintiff usually has the burden. In this case, it's reversed. The ABC test is something everybody definitely wants to get familiar with. It is part of the Biden administration's goal to enact it at the federal level. The ABC test, I should say AB5, so California's ABC test, is what he's looking to enact. It's actually part of legislation, the PRO Act, that's currently pending. And if it passed, it would be passed at the national level, thereby preempting all these other factor-based tests that states may have in place. So definitely something to keep in mind over the next year or so. If you see that PRO Act passed, you should get worried.
Yeah, I just want to emphasize again how big of a difference that is to how much bigger of a hurdle. Like you said, the other tests are factor-based. So if you have a majority of the factors, you know, there's a chance, but now they're trying to pass this test so that if you need to, complete these three prongs, and if you don't fall into each and every single one, you know, you satisfy two, one you don't, you're an employee. That's a big deal.
So what people aren't realizing is it's really being based on the California law, is it not? The AB5, which
yes.
is the ABC test, and it's really from California where that all stems from.
Well, yes and no. So other states do have ABC tests.
Mm-hmm.
California is kind of like the ABC test on steroids.
Yeah.
So like in New Jersey, they have the ABC test, but it's a little bit different. Massachusetts has a form of the ABC test. There's other states out there that have it. California has just made it extremely difficult. And they have some exceptions, which we'll talk about, but they're for the staffing industry.
Mm-hmm.
There's right. no exceptions.
Right.
Let's put it
right.
that way. They're very hard to come by.
So
yeah,
let's dig into the AB5 of California, or the ABC, and let's talk about each of those three tests. Can we dig into each of those?
Yep, sure. So the first thing to understand is basically a lot of what Sarah covered at the opening is California's wage and hour laws, their workplace safety laws, their retaliation laws, their meal period laws. They're some of the most employee friendly or are the most employee friendly in the entire country, right? So if you classify somebody as an IC and they really should be an employee, well, you just deprive them of all those benefits.
Right.
So that is one of the repercussions by misclassification. the governor did sign in to legislation, the ABC test, or AB under AB 5 in 2019. It was basically a codification of common law, which involved the Dynamex case. It was also later amended by AB 2257, which again, it just added additional exemptions to the ABC test. So it was the three factors that we discussed. And what you're looking at is part A of that test, you're looking at the control, right? Do you control the person like you would control an employee? If you have that same type of control, then that person is going to be reclassified as an employee. It doesn't matter whether it's through a contractual right or if it's just by practice, right? You can call an independent contractor all you want. They can say, yes, I'm an independent contractor. It does not matter. All that matters is the substance of it. They gave a couple of examples, California did. The first example that they gave was an employer failed to establish that at work home or work at home knitter and sewer who made clothing were sufficiently free of control where the company provided the patterns for them to sew, right? So they said, what California came back and said was, well, whether you're doing it at home or in the office, you're doing the same job. So that didn't matter. They also gave an example that a construction company that provided a worker who specialized in historic reconstruction was sufficiently free of control, where he set his own schedule, he worked without supervision, and he purchased all the materials using his own business credit card and also declined to accept employment by them. All right. So essentially, if you're setting pay rates, hours, you're paying for expenses, setting their schedules, the requisite controls is likely going to be there. Then you jump into part B, which is work outside the usual course of the business. And in my experience, staffing firms, this is where you fail all the time, right? Because you'll have, let's go IT, right? You have a programmer that you hired as a W-2. Well, now you hired a programmer as an IC. They're doing the exact same job or similar jobs. You can't have it both ways, right? Mm-hmm. If your employee is doing this job, you can't bring in somebody else, right? I mean, the simple examples are, you know, a retail store hires a plumber. Yeah, obviously going to be an IC, right? Or if a baker hires a decorator, that's not going to be an IC, right? Because it's part of your business, your typical course of business. I have talked to staffing firms where they've said, well, we're not providing services, we're providing human capital, which, you know, it's a creative argument. I don't think it's going anywhere because you're generating the revenue from the services of that human capital, right? That's how everybody makes money, is through human capital. So I don't think that's going to work. And then lastly, you have the worker is customarily engaged in an independent established trade, occupation, or business of the same nature of the work performed for the hiring entity. So first, A, you're going to have an entity formed, a true entity, not some entity that could be formed later in the future. So whether it be an LLC, S corporation, C corporation, it has to be a real entity. You're also going to have to show that it is a real entity, right? So what's a real entity? If you were starting a business, you would have a website, you would have a physical address, phone numbers, you would have business insurance, you'd have a license, you'd start advertising, you'd hold yourself out to the public to being able to perform these services, right? And you wouldn't be just relying on one customer, right? And in fact, California's come out and said, if you're relying on one customer for all your income, if you're a single member LLC or single member LLC or single shareholder S corp, you're going to be reclassified, right? That corporate status isn't going to protect you. So what we tell our clients is, if you're entering a C2C with somebody, you really want to make sure that they have multiple clients and multiple employees, right? And the clients aren't necessarily as important, but you definitely want to have multiple employees where you have back office people, not just your service providers, right? You need to show that you're a true business. And it's a pretty big hurdle, because when you get into the industries where the people are highly sought after, there's a high demand for them, and where they can dictate the terms, if you don't hire them, well, somebody else is going to take that risk and hire them. So it really becomes a business decision all the time. What I always tell people is, what's your margin say, right? What's your exposure here? If you're getting a 50% margin, you know, it's it's probably worth it. You're getting a 5% margin. I would say, mm-mm. Don't do it.
Right. Right. That last one is where I think they'll fail easily also, is because where we see it is the independent contractor does not have really a business established. They're not advertising. They're just working for the client at this one location, and that's all they're doing.
Exactly. Yeah. So if you're an auditor, right? If I'm coming to audit you, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to Google you. If I can't find you anywhere, mm-hmm. it's going to be a problem, right? I'm setting off red flags. I'm going in with the perception already that you're not a true independent contractor.
Right.
So that is a problem.
So they've also talked about some of the exceptions. You talked about AB 2257, and then there's the proposition 22, right? And those are for, if I get it right, app-based, independent contractors and delivery-based services, I should say. What else? You might go into more about that. And is there other ones on the horizon that you could see that would be part of some of the exemptions?
Yeah, so there definitely are exemptions, like you said, for like the app delivery base. There's also exemptions for physicians, psychologists. There's all these types of exemptions. However, what you need to realize, even if you are exempted, they still need to pass that multi-factor Barillo test. So even if you're exempted, the analysis is not done yet. You still have to go through the same, it might not be as stringent as the ABC factors, but you're still going to need to prove, you know, the totality of the circumstances that you're a contractor and not an employee. Mm-hmm. And just to touch base back at to what Chris was saying, a lot of staffing owners are asking about the business-to-business exemption, just like what we were talking about before. But again, what everyone has to realize is this is a very narrow exemption under the ABC. It's not, you know, you think, oh, it's a business, another business, you know, it's not going to be an employee because it's two entities. But no, it's very, very narrow. Again, it goes back to, there are 12 specific factors. You know, that basically it's the control again. If the provider is in fact independent and not under the control and direction of the partnering business, as to the performance. Mm-hmm. Also, again, there should be a contract in writing. It's not 100% if it's in writing that you're an independent contractor, but it helps. Mm-hmm. Another good factor for the business is that the business is properly licensed under applicable law. So that's a good one to make sure if you're trying to go with the business to business. Again, like Chris said, a big one is a physical location, a separate physical location. It helps to prove that it's actually a business. Mm-hmm. Also, they're marketing themselves out to the public. They're not relying on the company for their only income. So that's a big one. And then also that they have an investment in their company. They purchase their own tools. They purchase their own vehicles. They have their own equipment. This is not someone coming in. You're not doing a business to business agreement. However, you're providing, the company's providing everything for them, because that goes back into the overall aspect of control here. So if they have an investment, stuff like that, that goes to the independent contractor rather than the control of an employee. Okay, so that's a big one. Yep. The business to business. Another one that staffing firms are talking about.
Sorry, I just want to jump in real quick. The main problem with the business exemption is that the contractor has to be providing to meet that exception, mm-hmm. directly to the staffing firm. And correct. Not to the client. Correct. So it would never work in the staffing industry, right? So you could meet all 11 of the other factors, you're going to fail that factor. So you're never going to meet that exemption.
Right. So it seems like a good exemption. And when you're looking at that, you're going, oh, good, good. But you have to remember it's very narrow. And the other one that staffing firms have been asking about is the referral agency exemption. So if you refer, then you're exempted. But however, again, this is narrow. A contractor would need to provide services to the client under the contractor's name without being required to deliver the services under the staffing firm's name. So that's a big one for the referral. Again, there can't be any restrictions on the contractor in order to serve the clients. You know, the referral agency shouldn't be involved in the actual work being performed by the contractor. They shouldn't be able to hire and fire, none of those types of decisions, because again, it goes back to this control. If you're controlling them, it's going to be a red flag that this is not a contract, independent contractor relationship. This is an employer relationship. Again, having the proper licenses, business registration, all those basic tests that apply to business goes really to the referral agency as well. So again, when you look at these, you're going, well, you know, referral agency, we can be exempted under that. It's usually not the case. It's hard to satisfy.
Wow. You would lend to believe that the IRS would want to go after staffing companies because it would be like the hot place to get penalties, to get the fines.
It's hard. It's complicated.
Mm-hmm. Usually they don't go after them unless, from what I've seen, what we've seen is if you have an aggrieved employee who's filing maybe unemployment benefits, mm-hmm. and that'll trigger the audit, right? Mm-hmm. Or if you're in California and you have class action lawsuits, you have plaintiff's attorneys just trying to find that one plaintiff so he can pull in or she can pull in a whole bunch of other people.
Or where I say is where you have a client who has an employee who was an employee and then they move into an independent contractor. I'm like, you can't do that. They can't be an employee half the year and then an independent contractor the rest of the year. It doesn't work that way.
100%.
That way. So can we talk about the other tests, the IRS tests and the DOL? Can you dig into that a little bit more for us?
Sure. So I'll talk about the IRS test a little bit. So the problem is if the IRS determines that there's been a misclassification, the employer could be subject to many fines, fees, back taxes. There are a lot of ramifications to this. Specifically, there could be a $50 fine for each W-2 employer that is misclassified, a fee of 1.5% of wages, 40% of FICA taxes not withheld from the employee, and then 100% of matching FICA taxes that they should have withheld. So this could really be devastating to an employer, these fees. So for purposes of federal income tax withholding, this IRS test is similar to the DOL test in that control is the dominating factor. I know we've talked about control, you know, over and over again, but that's just because it's the biggest prong to satisfy. Mm-hmm. So again, they shouldn't have control. They can control, you know, the actual task, but not how it's completed. So you can control the end result, but not the means to the end, if that makes sense. And then with the IRS, the good thing is it's not as stringent as the ABC in that it is a totality of the circumstance test again. So all factors are gonna be considered. So historically, there were a lot of factors. It was a 20-factor test. The good thing is they've simplified it. Yeah, 20 factors. They've simplified it a bit to fit into three main categories now, and that's going to be the category of behavioral control, financial control, and then type of relationship. So just getting into that first category of behavioral control, that's going to be, again, control, but also more specifically instructions. So is the company giving instructions to the independent contractor saying how they're going to work, when they're going to work? All of that goes into, you know, instructions. And if you're instructing, then that's control. In that same realm is training. If you're giving training to an independent contractor, you're basically telling them, this is how we want this done. You're not giving them any ability to make those decisions themselves. So you're saying this is it. So again, control. So that's that behavioral control prong. Then we get into the third prong for the IRS test is the financial control prong. So that's gonna be the extent of the worker's investment. Again, like we touched upon earlier, is the independent contractor buying their own tools? Are they covering the expenses to get the job done? Mm-hmm. Availability to market other customers. Again, do they have other customers? Are they relying on the company solely for their income? That's going to be a red flag. How are payments being made is a big one. Employees are generally guaranteed a regular wage amount, either hourly, weekly, for some time period, even if it's supplemented by commission. But an independent contractor is often paid a flat fee on a time materials basis. So those are big financial circumstances to look at when you're determining this prong. Mm-hmm. And then the third one is going to be the type of relationship. Is there a written contract? What is the worker defined on in the contract? Independent contractor. It's not determinative, but it's good to have in there. I believe states like California require it in there, even though, again, it doesn't mean they're going to be determined as that, but it helps. Benefits. Is the company giving the independent contractor any benefits, insurance, pension plans, any of that? Obviously, that's a big one. Another one is the permanency of the relationship. Is this a limited duration task relationship, or is this an indefinite relationship? If it's an indefinite relationship, it goes more towards an at-will employment. So that's another one you gotta look out for. There was a good example on the IRS website that I thought would be beneficial to share. So they have an example that John Smith, he's an experienced tile setter. He orally agreed with the corporation to perform full-time services. He uses his own tools and performs services in the order designated by the corporation and according to the corporation's specifications. The corporation supplies all materials, makes frequent inspections of his work, pays him on a piecework basis, and carries worker compensation insurance on him. He doesn't have a place of business and doesn't hold himself out to the public to perform similar services. Either party can end the services at any time. Obviously, John Smith is an employee of the company. So I thought, you know, and it's good to go check out the IRS website. You can do that. They do have detailed examples. You know, it's good to read into it just so you can cover all bases. But I thought that was a good one.
That is. At the end of the day, it's really the employer's responsibility to correctly classify an independent contractor, correct? I mean, they're the ones that, if I came in and said I'm an independent contractor, it's my, wherever I'm going, the employer's responsibility to do those tests, right? So am I correct on that? It's not, they have to prove it, right? Not correct. Me, I don't have to prove it. So what are there any procedures or safeguards provided by the IRS to assist employers in making this classification correct, doing this correctly? Or when they have made it, maybe they have misclassified something to remedy, there we go, the situation.
Yes, and it's true, because like you just touched upon, if the employer makes the misclassification, the employer is paying all the fees that we just talked about. So it's important to get it right. The good thing is that the IRS does have several safeguards to help employers figure this out and to remedy any misclassifications they may have. So one of them is both the company and any worker can request a classification determination by the IRS by filling out what's called a form SS-8. The determinations can only be requested for future tax periods. It can't go back for periods with the statute of limitations is already gone for, but you can go forward. It is a process where they will ask for all sorts of relevant information from the employer, the worker, from the relationship, and also third parties if they feel it necessary. So they're going to try and get as much information to make this determination as accurate as possible.
We don't suggest this.
What?
We do not suggest going that route.
No. It's a long route too. It takes a long time too.
You're asking for an audit.
Right.
You're asking, exactly. Well, right. You are.
Go this way, please.
It's just, it is out there. So, what Chris said, it is an avenue. It does take up to 6 months, if not longer. So it is a lengthier process. And the problem, like what Chris said too, once they make a decision, it's binding. It's a binding decision. So as long as there's not any change of circumstances going on, then that's going to be the binding decision as to what it is. So again, you know, just so you know, it's out there. It's something that can be done.
But advice says don't use it.
Yes. Chris says no, but just
call your attorney.
Call your attorney.
Yeah, okay. Turn it off. Another avenue is that back in 2011, the IRS also announced a voluntary classification program. So this actually provides an opportunity for taxpayers to reclassify their workers as employees for future tax periods. And if you do this, you do get, you know, partial relief for federal employment tax purposes. So that's good. The employers will only have to pay, I believe, 10% of the employment tax liability from the previous years. There's no interest charge, interest charges or penalties. However, there are requirements for participation. Of course, there's always the limits here. So you do apply using a form that's on the IRS website. And you touched upon this before, Julie, you must have consistently treated the subject worker as a 1099 for all applicable years. You can't have classified them as an employee, then they're an independent contractor, then they're employee, and now you're nervous. No, it had to be consistent. If they were anything else, you cannot get into this program. You can't have any current audits outstanding by the IRS in any state. So you can't be audited. You can't know that you're being audited and go, wait. No, it's got to be, nothing can be outstanding. And then if there were any previous audits in the past, they have been rectified, all payments. There can be nothing outstanding because it's a beneficial program. Timing-wise, the application needs to be filed at least 60 days prior to the date that you want to start reclassifying the subject worker. Of course, the IRS says 60 days. I would do it way more in advance because you just never know with the IRS. On the website, it says they'll make every effort to abide by this timeline. But again, you know, you want to give yourself a little leeway here. And then the eligible taxpayers, if they're accepted, they will have to enter into a closing agreement with the IRS, which goes into exactly, you know, what they have to pay for any violation before. And all those payments need to be made before it's settled. But it is a good avenue. Mm-hmm. If there's any, you know, any question, it's a good avenue to go.
Interesting. It is. It's a good avenue on the federal side.
Yes. Yes.
It does not protect you on the state side.
Yes.
So, good to know. Good to know. Okay. So let's then discover and now dig into DOL, the economic realities test, since there's all these different tests. They're very complicated.
There are many tests. That's why it's so complicated.
But they're all very similar, right? Yes. I think so. The DOL's test it's a 7-factor based test. Again, what I'm going to say is going to sound very familiar because you've already heard it. It's the extent to which the business or the services are rendered are an integral part of the principal business. Again, part of the ABC test and part of the IRS test. The permanency of the relationship, part of the IRS test. The amount of the alleged contractor's investment in facilities and equipment, part of both tests again. Degree of control. Their opportunity for profit and loss, which to me is the telltale one all the time. It's the first question I ask whenever somebody calls me is, do they have an opportunity for loss? Or are you just paying them, that they invoicing you and you're paying them, you know, net 30 days, net 45 days? They say, mm-hmm. Yes. I said, well, they're probably an employee. The amount of initiative that they take in marketing themselves and trying to get other clients, and the degree of their business operations. So again, they're all very similar. They all kind of really jive together. Like we said, the IRS test and the economic realities test is just factor-based. So you could fail. So for this, let's say you fail 6 of them, you pass one. If that one is a really big factor in the DOL's eyes, well, you've just passed the test, right? Even though you might've failed 6 other parts. So they're much easier to pass. If you do fail the DOL test, you are subject to fines up to $1,000. Again, you do have your collective class action suits that could be filed as well. And if the DOL and IRS are talking, which who knows how often they talk, the IRS could obviously come back to you as well.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Let's talk about the staffing industry in itself, specifically with independent contractors, because we see a lot of it. I'm shocked at still how much we're seeing out there. And I feel like a lot of it is misclassified. So what do you see, kind of summarize what you could see for the industry and help them understand what they should be looking at and making and kind of helping them with their decisions here.
Yeah, so you really want to look at the types of instructions given, right? If you're, again, if you're setting, if they're purchasing the tools, great. If you're purchasing tools, not great. If you're setting the sequence of work, not great. And if they have to perform the work individually, again, that's going to be an employer-employee relationship. You also want to look at the degree of instruction, right? The more instruction you give, it more looks like an employee-employee relationship, because you're supposed to be hiring an IC for their professional expertise that you otherwise don't have in-house. Obviously, you're providing training, big no. The investment piece, investing in tools, your expenses, your assessment being the IC's expenses, they should not be reimbursed, right? In the staffing industry, they typically are reimbursed, right? Mm-hmm. But whether you gross up their rate to avoid that or not, that is a way around it. Then, like I said, the opportunity for profit and loss is the biggest thing in my mind, right? Okay. If you're paying them like you're paying an employee, hourly rate, or even if they have no opportunity for loss, if they don't have a paid when paid clause, so basically if the client doesn't, or if the staffing firm doesn't get paid, you have no obligation to pay the IC. If that's not in there, that's going to be a red flag, right? Because they're supposed to take on the same risk of not getting paid that you are, right? They're, mm-hmm. you're a real business entity. All business entities have that risk. Employees don't have that risk, right? Because by law, right. you don't get paid.
Right.
Your employer is going to jail. So it has to stay consistent with that. And also, I think there, you also have to have the written contracts, but their services have to be available to market. So if you're putting them in restrictive covenants, if you're putting restrictive covenants in your IC agreements, that's going to be an employee-employee relationship.
Mm-hmm.
And then the final one is, like we talked about earlier, if you have W-2s doing the same work, you can't call them ICs. Mm-hmm. It can't happen. That's one of the first things they're going to look at.
Yeah, you've given some really great explanations and examples of things that I've never thought of, the loss, the experience of loss, because I've never even thought of that or discussed that with clients, the potential of a loss. And I don't know if many are having in their contracts. So I would, that's one of the big things you would probably negotiate or tell your client is put that in the contract, right?
100%. It has to be in the contract. And listen, you can do it. You could say you're paid when we get paid. However, we have the right to advance you monies, right? As a loan. But if we don't get paid, then we're going to pay it back. So at least you can still stay on paying them every 30, 45 days, whatever it is, but it acts as a loan at that point. So if you don't get paid, they have an obligation to pay you back. So that's one way to get around it, but at least you still have a paid when paid clause.
Okay. So here's a question on that paid when we get paid, like in our business. So we're funding those receivables. Mm-hmm. And so we're funding the payroll basically, and they're paying the independent contractor weekly or biweekly. They're not paid yet. They're not paid on that receivable yet. They're basically paying them weekly or biweekly, like a regular employee.
Yep. And that's going to be, that'll be a tough hurdle to overcome for them. For
right. Sure. That's what I would think, because they're not waiting for the receivable to come in. The receivable is not coming in for another 30, 45, 60 days.
Yeah. So, I mean, you could do it that way, right? But you better have the advance that we have the right in our sole discretion to advance you the money, which mm-hmm. will act as a loan. And then if we don't collect on it within X amount of days, we can recoup that, offset it from any future payments due to you. You know, just language to make sure that they know a loss could be out there or you might have to pay this back.
So those are things that you would work through with your customers to have in their agreements, because you would want to understand how often they're paying them, when they're paying them. And you would want to get some type of protection for them in there if they make that choice, really, to go forward with an independent contractor status. Is there other things that you would, you know, you've talked about other ones too, but that just came to mind is we're paying them weekly and I know they're not getting paid for 45 or 60 days.
Yeah, no, really every industry is different, right? Mm-hmm. You know, LI is going to be that weekly, bi-weekly, like you said. The IT industry is more 30 to 45 days. So you have that little bit of leeway, but you're still not getting those receivables in that 30, 40, maybe within the 45 days you might, right? But then the IT industry, the ICs are more receptive to it because it's more normalized. Whereas mm-hmm. LI, it's not, right? You expect to be paid weekly or bi-weekly. Right. So you need that language probably more in the LI than mm-hmm. you do even in the IT. But even with your IT, you should, or your scientific, your engineering, whatever.
Okay. Any other documents owners should be asking for from the independent contractor that support that onboarding of that contractor to help them safeguard against any misclassifications?
Yeah, so you definitely want to ask for the proof of formation, proof of good standing. So get a good standing certificate from saying, yes, they're up to date, they're in compliance with all their filing requirements. Some states, some localities do require business licenses. Get those. Get a copy of that. Obviously, you want their EIN, W-9. I like to ask for how many employees do you have, right? If you only have one or two employees, three employees, I probably don't want to do business with you as an IC. You know, I'll hire you as an employer, but they're just too much risk, right? Mm-hmm. You also want to see how many clients they have, maybe by asking for a proof of redacted contracts, right? What else do you have out there? What else do you have going on right now? You definitely want the certificate of insurance with you named as an additional insured. That's one big thing. I think in some industries, right, make sure you're hiring the person you think you are. Yeah. I've seen this a lot in the, where you're getting a lot of H1Bs, mm-hmm. Where you'll talk to somebody on the phone and when you see and you get their license, but then when they show up, it's a totally different person. So you want to make sure you have that Zoom call with their license in their hand showing you so you can recognize that person when they show up. So they're not, the company's not kind of duping you.
Right.
And then another big thing too is, and this is more international, if you're dealing with international consultants or companies, make sure the contract you sent over is the contract being signed. I've seen it multiple times where you'll send over a PDF, that PDF will come back signed. Stuff that you put in there will be taken out without them telling you. Wow. And there's no way to run a compare with a PDF. So you don't know unless you sit there and read it. So people are scrupulous. I don't think it happens so much in US-based companies, but if you are dealing internationally, it's something definitely to be aware of.
That's a shocker.
Yeah.
I would never do that. I would never think of doing that.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, with DocuSign and all that now, it makes it easier because they can edit it, right?
Right.
But if you're just emailing back and forth PDFs, that's when it becomes the issue.
Thank you for DocuSign. It's the save the day now. It really is. Yeah. It really is. Okay. Anything else that you can share with our listeners today on this topic that's an ongoing debate?
Yeah, I think there are some other contract provisions too. I mean, we touched upon a whole bunch of them, but just for protection to be included in staffing contracts, it's a good idea to get a compliance with law provision is a good provision to get in there so that the contractor is essentially saying they're going to comply with the laws. And that goes also towards like indemnities. So if you have an independent contractor and there's any claims for discrimination, benefits, payment of wages, anything like that, if you have a good compliance with law provision saying that they're going to comply and they haven't, and then also an indemnification provision, those are going to help protect you just generally in your contracts. Mm-hmm. Limitations of liability provisions are big. I know Chris is very familiar with these, but getting those in the contract is good. It will limit the company's liability in the chance that a contractor does violate any laws or there's any sort of claims against them. So just touching generally about independent contractors, I think, you know, obviously having the contract as protective as possible is good, is what should be
the goal. A very different agreement for your independent contractors than for somebody else then, right. Really.
Yeah, really different, really different. So that's why when you're drafting these agreements, it's different than an employee contract. For sure, to get these different provisions in here that kind of go towards that they are this like separate entity, and you know, you don't want to be on the hook for anything that they do just because you know you're involved with it as well.
And how often, because the laws are changing so drastically, you know, I've got to believe that these contracts need to be looked at. If not annually, are you thinking sooner than that, or just annually is good enough having them reviewed by attorney?
Yeah, I think it depends on the state that you're in, where you're doing business. If you start going to other states, let's say you're just in one state, now you're starting to grow, which a lot of staffing companies are thankfully starting to grow, right? They're expanding to other states. You definitely need to look at those state laws. You may have to update your independent contractor agreements, your employee agreements. Because you will have...
Because you said very early on, like California has that ABC test, but states have different, you know, ABC tests. So you have to make sure when you're doing these contracts, you know, you're putting in the state specific rules.
Right. And that's one thing too. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Sorry, Julie. No. Just for the indemnification, when you're hiring an IC, and you really want to hire IC, and you probably shouldn't be hiring an IC, get the indemnification that they're agreeing that they had to comply with this contract, any breaches of the contract, because you're going to have clauses in there saying where they're representing that they took this job as an IC, they're responsible for all employment taxes, everything that comes of it, that if any joint employer relationships found or an employment relationships found, they're going to indemnify you for that. So at least whether it ever holds up, who knows? But at least you're putting them on notice that, yeah, if you're found to be an employee, I expect you to reimburse me all my penalties, fees, back wages as well. So I think it's definitely an important piece when you're tying in the indemnifications, where you're not going to see those indemnifications in an employment agreement. And the last thing I'll say on it is make sure on IC agreements that you're flowing down all the client's MSA's terms, right? Because that's on you.
I was going to say too.
Yeah, get that to your ICs, right? Where there may be certain obligations that you have to the client. Well, these people are not your employees, so they don't have the same duty of loyalty to you that an employee would have. So now you have to flow down those terms.
Wow. Yeah, I guess my advice to anybody would be get an attorney involved, get Becker LLC involved, anybody that specializes really in staffing that knows it, and in multi-state, because like you said, Wisconsin could be one thing compared to California, very different, very different than New York, than New Jersey and everything else on the East Coast. So if you're going to go down that path of having independent contractors, get your attorney involved. And if your attorney is not specializing in staffing, Becker is a great group to be working with. We work with you guys. You guys do a great job. You guys are great in the industry. And make sure they understand, if you're not in one state and you're in multiple states, that they understand that. You better be open to them about what you're doing.
Yeah. Right?
Yeah.
Thank you, Jill.
I'd be very, very leery about hiring an independent contractor. Very scared of it. Very leery.
100%. I think the trend is start converting ICs to W-2s or just hiring W-2s.
Right. I agree. Well, thank you. I'm going to give you an opportunity if you have anything else to close with, but this was great information today. Excellent information. I really appreciate it.
Appreciate you taking the time.
Well, thank you, Julian. Thank you.
You guys are busy. I appreciate it. Thank you so much. Great information for our listeners. And I'll make sure that they know that they can call you to further discuss independent contractors if they have any more to learn about it. But yeah, there's still a lot. I mean, there's a lot. And you'd be happy to help them on this subject.
For sure.
Definitely.
Great. Thank you, we both. Have a great day.
You too.
Have a good day.